Christian and also PI at the Center for Molecular Medicine. And I will be discussing with you a disease that is called atherosclerosis. And we will quickly look what is behind the disease, what are the risk factors, what are the health statistics, and what is the new view about the pathogenesis of the disease. And we will end by discussing possible treatment, current and then possible future treatment options. So, what is atherosclerosis? Atherosclerosis is a chronic inflammatory disease, and you're always welcome to interrupt me and ask questions if there's something is unclear. By the way, if you looked at the handouts from the website, I only sent these slides at noon to Mr. Jankos. You may have still the ones from last year, so these are the new ones. So there may be some that are not identical, just in case you're confused. So atherosclerosis is a chronic inflammatory disease of the vascular wall, particularly of arterial blood vessels. You know there's veins and arteries are the ones where the oxygen-rich blood is transported. And the large and medium-sized arterial blood vessels are the sites where atherosclerosis develops. And that can start very early by so-called fatty streak lesions that are characterized by simply the deposition of lipid underneath the endothelial cell layer. But over decades, these lesions can become more complex and eventually can rupture, and all the material that is accumulated in these lesions or in these plaques can then come into contact with the circulation and the blood, and that can lead to a thrombotic event, for example, at the site of the coronary arteries, causing a heart attack. So, many of you may not be familiar with how a typical blood vessel is built. And so arteries typically have three major layers or four major layers. The most inner layer that is in contact with the blood is the endothelial cell layer, which is basically just one layer of endothelial cells that basically separate the bloodstream from the blood vessel. And underneath this endothelial cell layer, you have a very small air layer that is called intima, which is separated by elastic lamina, elastic basement membrane, from the smooth muscle cell layer that is called media, surrounded by fibrous tissue called epitissue. And here the intima layer is actually where the site where atherosclerotic lesions develop. So when a plaque develops, you usually have these fatty streak lesions, which are only characterized by the deposition of lipids underneath these endothelial cells in the so-called intima layer. And then they can actually start to accumulate also extracellular lipid, which is then not found inside the cells that accumulate underneath these endothelial cells, and we will discuss that in detail later, and eventually can form what is called an atheroma that is characterized by a lipid-rich core, so a core that has particularly extracellular lipid and is only surrounded by a cell-rich area, and eventually you have also fibrous tissue that is like in a wound healing process, migrating from muscle cells, which then eventually can form these complicated lesions that are really the dangerous lesions, because they then can cause a thrombotic event leading to clinical manifestations. So what are the clinical manifestations that atherosclerosis is responsible for? The three major clinical manifestations are, on the one hand, stroke. So if you have atherosclerosis in the carotid artery that is supplying the blood to the brain, and you have a lesion that is developing here, and the thrombus that is generated here, the thrombus can then travel further up and then clog an artery that is supplying a specific brain area here, and then you have a so-called ischemic stroke, because then the brain area that is supplied doesn't have enough blood supply, causing the typical stroke lesion. Another prominent clinical consequence of atherosclerosis is heart attacks. And in heart attacks, it's the coronary blood vessels where you have atherosclerotic lesions and where you have thrombi that can form and then clog an artery. And depending on which coronary artery is affected, a specific heart area will be not supplied with oxygen and blood, and therefore you will have tissue damage, which eventually will end up in necrosis if you do not open up this blood vessel quickly enough. And that's a typical ECG sign how heart attacks look. Another less commonly known cause of or consequence of atherosclerosis is peripheral artery disease, which eventually can result in a bad circulation in the leg and ischemia in the feet, which often can end up in amputation of these feet. So these are very common consequences of atherosclerosis. And just to illustrate to you how common this disease is, I would like to share with you this slide in which you can see a statistic about the global cause of death. And so this is not only in Western countries, but it's really globally. And you can see that cardiovascular disease account for 31% of all death worldwide. And when you then look in more detail into these cardiovascular diseases, you can see that the majority, three quarters of it, are really due to ischemic heart disease, so heart attacks, or cerebrovascular disease, which is primarily ischemic strokes. So there you can already see that actually atherosclerosis is really causing the most death worldwide, and is also a global killer. And it's not getting better, really, because when you look at the statistics this extrapolation of these data here, you can see actually that within the next 30 or 25 year or 15 years, you will have a dramatic increase in death due to cardiovascular disease. So the top line here is actually cancer, but this actually includes all types of cancer. But when you look here at ischemic heart disease and stroke and put these both together, which are both caused by atherosclerosis, you would have actually in 2030 about 18 million deaths due to atherosclerosis. So it's really responsible for the most death worldwide. And this is really striking, because we now understand much more about this disease, about the risk factors of this disease, and independent of that, it's still dramatically increasing and getting more and more, probably in part also due to the fact that we have the population is getting older, as you will see later on. So when you look, for example, here, and I could recommend to you this very interesting website where you can actually put in all kinds of data and can look at the statistics of individual countries to see and understand what is the cause of death and what is the cause of morbidity in different countries across different age groups and between different genders. And this is just divided the causes of death worldwide according to age groups, and you have here in light blue cardiovascular disease, whereas these here, light blue, is neoplasms, so mostly cancer. So at a young age, obviously, you have primarily neonatal disorders and nutritional deficiencies, or diarrhea, as you have it, for example, in Africa, responsible for a lot of death with newborns and young children. But the older the individuals are, the more common you can see cardiovascular disease is responsible for the majority of death, and this is starting already at the age of 60, where it's even more prevalent than cancer, as you can see here. This is a little bit different when you look in Austria, where you can see that at the age of 60 or so, cancer is still more dominant cause of death compared to cardiovascular disease. But as soon as as individuals get older, cardiovascular disease takes over, and it's really the number cause of death in the aging population. So it's a growing problem, because our population is also growing. This is just the statistics from the Statistic Austria from last year. And it's remarkable when you think that in Austria last year, 43% of all people died of causes of cardiovascular disease. And as I mentioned to you before, the majority of it is due to atherosclerosis or ischemic heart disease. All right. So how this, I mentioned to you that this disease is actually slowly developing and is developing from very early on over decades as a disease that we don't feel actually, and it only leads to clinical manifestations mostly in older individuals. But there's two studies that I would like to share with you that have particularly looked at the prevalence of atherosclerosis in autopsies, or in this case in hearts from heart transplant donors, so typically accident victims, where the hearts were used for organ transplantation. And these investigators actually took a method that is called intravascular ultrasound to measure the extent of atherosclerosis in the coronary arteries of these hearts. And you can see when the donors were below 20 in age, already 17% had already measurable atherosclerosis present in the coronary arteries, and that increased over time with an age of 30 to 39, more than half of the hearts that were investigated here had already visible atherosclerosis. Now, this was not the only study. There is a second study that actually did a similar investigation using necroscopy data from accident victims. And in this case, they did not look by intravascular ultrasound, but what they did is actually that they measured by means of histology the extent of atherosclerosis and then determined the percentage of coronary artery disease in the hearts that were investigated. And you can see here, these are these yellow bars. The numbers add up. They are very similar to the other study that you have seen before. Again, telling that already at the age of 30 to 40, you have more than 50% of coronary artery disease present in the hearts. So most of these, obviously, as I mentioned to you, are inapparent and they don't cause any symptoms. However, it can also hit people at a younger age, and this is a very interesting example of a typical premature cardiovascular death caused by a heart attack. As you see, two blocked arteries, a very famous baseball player actually from the Chicago Cardinals, who was found dead in a hotel room at the age of 33. And what it turns out later on that he had a familial disorder that is associated with premature cardiovascular disease, and that is a very important familial disorder called familial hypercholesterolemia, because it has taught us a lot about the pathogenesis of this disease. So familial hypercholesterolemia obviously tells you already that cholesterol is involved. So what is cholesterol? Cholesterol is a lipid, as you know, and the majority of cholesterol is really generated or made in the liver and then secreted by bile acids into the gut. And a small part is also taken up by the diet. For example, red meat or butter is rich in cholesterol. And then some of it is actually excreted with the feces, but another portion of it is actually taken up again through specific sterol transporters, and then it's packaged in so-called chylomicrons. So these chylomicrons have a phospholipid layer, and inside they're rich in triglycerides and cholesterol, and they are circulating in our circulation. It's also what you have when you get fresh milk, when there's cream on it. This is typically chylomicrons. And if you had, if you just had lunch and I would draw blood from you, you would have also a layer of these chylomicrons in your blood that would float up, because it's the lipids that very quickly reach your bloodstream through the gut. Now these chylomicrons actually circulate in the bloodstream, and by the means of a specific enzyme that is located in the vasculature called lipoprotein lipase, they actually get rid of free fatty acids which come from the triglycerides. And these free fatty acids, or fatty acids, are very important energy for our muscles and for our tissues. And what is then remaining are so-called chylomicron remnants that are more enriched in cholesterol, and there are very little triglycerides in it. And they are taken up by a specific receptor that is called the LDL receptor, which then transports the cholesterol into the liver. Now, inside the liver, the cholesterol is packaged again in specific particles, so-called lipoprotein particles. And they have been characterized in the 50s by ultracentrifugation according to the density. And so therefore we have different types of low density and very low density and high density lipoproteins according to the density where you could actually find them in a centrifugation gradient by ultracentrifugation. So these very low density lipoproteins are rich in cholesterol but also very rich in triglycerides. And similar to the chylomicrons, they actually circulate in the blood, and then when they get into contact with the endothelial lipoprotein lipases, they can then get rid of the fatty acids from the triglycerides, provide energy, and then become intermediate density lipoproteins, so they're a bit poorer in triglycerides, and eventually also low density lipoproteins, which are particles that have very little triglycerides but are rich in cholesterol. And this low-density lipoprotein cholesterol, we will talk about this a lot today, are the major transporters of cholesterol in the bloodstream. And they have an important function, and that is actually that they transport cholesterol to the peripheral tissues, so the tissues that are not the liver, extrahepatic tissues, to provide cholesterol to these tissues for different things that we will discuss later on. But the majority of it actually is then transported back to the liver where where it enters the enterohepatic cycle, again cholesterol excreted into the gut, part of it is taken up again in chylomicrons. Now there is a different lipoprotein called high-density lipoproteins, which have very high density, as the name says, and they have been identified, and they are very poor in cholesterol originally, and they have an important purpose because these particles actually a part of maintaining cholesterol homeostasis or a balance of cholesterol homeostasis in the cells of the extrahepatic tissue and take away the excess cholesterol to transport it back to the liver by a specific receptor called SRB1 where they can also provide for the pool of cholesterol in the liver. Now, cholesterol is very important, obviously, to us. But the question is if the cholesterol that we find in our blood, the levels of cholesterol that we find in our blood, are too high or not. And this is a very good example that actually shows you that when you compare the LDL cholesterol levels across the animal kingdom, you can see that most animals, including dogs and cats, have very low LDL cholesterol levels, and only carnivores like lions have a bit elevated cholesterol. Now in humans, when you look at newborns, for example, the umbilical cord blood, you can see also that the LDL cholesterol levels are rather low in newborns, and also in only normal adults, they go up to typically 130 milligrams per deciliter. Now there are some individuals, and we will talk about this later, and we mentioned this baseball player, who have excessively high cholesterol levels in the blood. And they are suffering from a disease that is called familial hypercholesterolemia, which is an autosomal dominant disease where you have heterozygous and homozygous forms. And we will talk about this later on because this specific genetic disorder has taught us a lot about the pathogenesis of atherosclerosis. Now, atherosclerosis and the connection of cholesterol with atherosclerosis is actually goes back quite a few years, because already at the end of the 19th century, a young physician who worked at the army in St. Petersburg, Nikolai Anichkov, actually discovered a very close connection between cholesterol and the development of atherosclerotic lesions. And what he did is he did an experiment where he fed a rabbit cholesterol in the diet, so rich in butter, and then waited for 124 days. So he kept feeding this rabbit for 124 days. And then he sacrificed the rabbit and then took out the aorta. And then he had already then available a specific dye that stains neutral lipids. We use it also nowadays to stain for lipids. And he could see that in the aorta of this rabbit, there's a region where you don't find any cells, but there's some staining for lipids. And then he finds some other cells that have lipids inside. And this is really a hallmark of atherosclerotic lesions, as we will see later on. Obviously, he did not have, he couldn't take any pictures, so he looked under the microscope and had to do his hand drawings. And then he did another study that was very interesting, where he basically first fed a rabbit cholesterol for only 106 days, and then returned it back on a chow diet, so on a regular diet that is poor in cholesterol, for 785 days. Just imagine what kind of project this is that goes over years and just having a few rabbits, or maybe only one rabbit. And then he examined again the aorta, and you can see there's only very few areas where you stain, where he could see some stainings with the lipids, but he finds some clefts here that is more an acellular region where there's sort of where there used to be obviously something, which we now know are the remainders of cholesterol crystals that leave some areas there. So he already actually did then a regression study, what we call this now, where he first fed a rabbit a high cholesterol diet and then put it back on a low fat diet and see that it has an effect, that there's still some visible damage to the vasculature, but what is gone completely is actually the lipid deposition. So it was actually not until the 1980s when two really exceptional scientists won the Nobel Prize for understanding the mechanism that is behind that familial disease of familial hypercholesterolemia. It's Joe Goldstein and Mike Brown, who worked on these patients that had excessive hypercholesterolemia and were dying of heart attacks at a very young age. And what they identified in these patients, that there is a defect in one specific receptor on cells, on liver cells, that is responsible for the clearance of LDL cholesterol from the circulation. And that receptor is the LDL receptor. And not only that, they actually, by doing that, for the first time really discovered this whole system about LDL or receptor-mediated uptake and regulation of receptor-mediated uptake. So what you see here, it's a disease that is characterized by premature cardiovascular disease. And typically, typically these individuals have a mutation in the LDL receptor, so the LDL receptor is not functional, but they can also have mutations in genes like in ApoB, which is actually the ligand on LDL for the LDL receptor, or in another gene which is more recently discovered, PCSK9, and we will talk about this later on. It's inherited in an autosomal dominant manner. Sorry. And the heterozygous form of FH is actually quite prevalent, and there's some estimates that in Austria you have about 30,000 patients suffering from heterozygous FH, and only 2 or 3% of them have been diagnosed. So which is actually why there's a strong initiative now to have a registry of HH patients, because these are families where the children can be affected as well, and to follow up them and to treat them early enough so one can prevent the consequences such as premature cardiovascular disease. So what they found is that the LDL receptor that sits on the surface of hepatocytes, liver cells, they bind to LDL via ApoB, and this is the way how actually cholesterol enters the cell, and they then will end up in the endosome, which then releases, where the receptor releases cholesterol. Part of it is recycled back, some other parts are being degraded of the receptor depending on the levels of sterols or cholesterol inside the cells, and what they found that actually this mechanism and the intracellular levels of cholesterol are responsible for a number of genes that control the synthesis of cholesterol. So what is cholesterol important for in general? Why do you need it, cholesterol? For the cell membrane, the rigidity of the cell membrane. And another important thing for the adrenal glands and for other glands, they're important for steroid hormones. And obviously also bile acids. But the really important is obviously cell membranes and steroid hormones. So this is why cells need cholesterol, but this is a tightly regulated mechanism. And 20 years later, actually, Brown and Goldstein discovered the exact molecular regulation of this whole pathway, because they identified a completely new way of genes that are responsive to cholesterol levels are regulated. So specific transcription factors, because one has to envision if a cell has enough of cholesterol inside, it completely shuts down the synthesis of cholesterol by shutting down the transcription of all the genes that are responsible for the synthesis, such as the HMG-CoA reductase, or the transcription of the gene that encodes the LDL receptor. So it's regulated, the synthesis and the uptake of cholesterol is regulated by intracellular cholesterol levels. And so they were wondering, how does this work? And what they found is a very sophisticated mechanism for a transcriptional regulation that is sensitive to sterols, which is the so-called sterol-responsive element binding protein pathway, or SREBP pathway. And this SREBP, this protein, actually sits in the endosomal reticulum, endoplasmatic reticulum, where it is actually held by a scaffolding protein called SCAP. And once the sterol levels are dropping, then this SREBP travels to the Golgi apparatus, where under the activity of one specific protease, this SREBP, these two SREBP domains are cleaved, releasing one of the domains called BHLH, which is then attacked by another protease called S2P, and that sink-dependent protein then releases that part of that protein which goes into the nucleus and acts as a transcription factor for all these genes that are responsible for cholesterol synthesis. And so it's a very sophisticated and physiologically regulated mechanism that is in place here to tightly control cellular cholesterol homeostasis. Now, if that doesn't work due to, for example, a defect in the LDL receptor, what is happening is that these individuals have very high cholesterol levels because they don't take up the LDL from the circulation into the liver because they are lacking the receptor. Or if the receptor for some reason is not presented on the surface. And so these individuals who have excessively high cholesterol levels and suffer from the disease called familial hypercholesterolemia, they actually develop deposits of cholesterol at many different sites, including at your knuckles here, which is called xanthomas, as well as on the Achilles heel, you have xanthomas, and you can have here xanthomas on the eyelids called xanthelasms, and you can have this arcus cornea or arcus lipoides cornea, which is where you can see in your cornea lipid deposits there, because there's so much excess cholesterol that it can deposit anywhere. But these are very extreme forms, and these are these individuals who suffer from this familial hypercholesterolemia. And while the deposition of cholesterol at your knuckles and the eyelids is not very dangerous, it's dangerous if it deposits in your vessel wall. So if you have now a mutation in the LDL receptor, and the LDL receptor does not work and therefore cannot take up chylomicrons and cannot take up LDL from the bloodstream, the logical consequence is that the LDL cholesterol go up in your blood, and LDL cholesterol has to deposit somewhere, which is, for example, in the blood, in the endothelial cells, in the intima of large arteries and medium-sized arteries, causing atherosclerotic lesions. And the process of formation of atherosclerotic lesions is called atherogenesis. Now, what would be then the normal cholesterol levels? Now, this is not looking at the LDL cholesterol, but this is looking at the total blood cholesterol, so from all the lipoproteins that I've mentioned to you. And typically, we say around 200 is normal. And obviously, when you look and measure this across a specific population, you will have a normal distribution with some individuals that have rather high levels of cholesterol, others that have a bit lower levels, but it's rather normally distributed. And this actually was... these were measurements that were done maybe in the late 90s in the United States, where you can see that actually according to our thresholds, so when you go to the doctor and you draw some or she draws some blood from you and then you measure cholesterol, you get a star if it is above 200. And so you see that the majority of this population actually had excessively high or high cholesterol levels above the normal threshold. But what is interesting is this curve here, and maybe you want to guess where this curve comes from. So it was also a population that was measured where they looked at the cholesterol levels.
Of the newborns, maybe?
That's a good idea. It was not newborns. It was actually from Japan. And this was before Japan sort of got hooked on fast food, and therefore they had really normal, much lower cholesterol levels. And you can see that there's only a very small part of that population that was above what we consider the threshold. How do you get these thresholds, actually? You get, what? Yeah, so what is a normal population? You get these thresholds basically by measuring 1,000 people, and then you get, you survey this, and this gives you the normal threshold. And this is the reason why we don't consider it really normal, is that we have seen that over the past years, these can change depending on dietary habits from one population to the other. And so the guidelines that tell you what is normal are usually typically going further down and down every year, because we know that the risk that is associated with this high cholesterol is still very high. And obviously you are fine with much lower cholesterol levels, because if you're a Japanese person, they get children and they're normal, and therefore there's nothing associated with low cholesterol levels that one should be worried about. The fact that the high cholesterol levels are really directly linked to the risk of developing coronary heart disease and then eventually develop a heart attack, or the risk of developing a stroke, is very nicely demonstrated on these two clinical studies that have actually simply looked at the association of serum and LDL cholesterol levels with the frequency of death due to coronary heart disease. And you can see those individuals that had high cholesterol levels had a significantly higher rate of heart attacks. And there's really a linear relationship. But what is particularly interesting in this slide is a study that is called the Shanghai study, because it was done with a Shanghai population from emigrants from Shanghai that came to Vancouver. And this specific population was investigated because they appeared to be particularly healthy, because they kept their old, they maintained their old dietary habits. And in that population, although what you see, all of them had actually the cholesterol levels below what we consider normal, so had actually healthy, what we thought healthy cholesterol levels, there is still a linear relationship between the levels of cholesterol in the blood of these individuals and the risk of getting a heart attack. And so you can see, if you would want to extrapolate this, one would need to have probably cholesterol levels of around 100 or 120 to avoid having heart attacks at all. I mean, it's not that simple, but it really tells you that there's a linear relationship. And this is why we believe that actually cholesterol levels is one of the major drivers of that disease. There's many other modulators, and we will discuss important modulators for this, but cholesterol is clearly a very important driver of that disease. And there's numerous studies that have looked at that, and that have really shown how strongly the cholesterol levels are linked with the development of atherosclerosis. So this is actually why cholesterol to some degree is bad news, but interestingly enough, actually the diet does not really contribute so much to our cholesterol levels. A lot is contributed to by genetics and by dietary habits over time, but having a meal of ham and eggs once does not really raise your cholesterol levels dramatically the next day. So the importance of cholesterol as a risk factor for the development of atherosclerosis was also very nicely demonstrated in the so-called Framingham Heart Study. And that Framingham Heart Study was a prospective observational study that eventually led to the definition of the Framingham Risk Score. And the goal of this study was to identify the major risk factors for cardiovascular disease and identify some valuable information by observing a population. And initially, the study started in 1948 in Framingham, which is a little town outside of Boston, Massachusetts. And in the meantime, the third generation, so the grandchildren of the original participants, are now enrolled in the study. And you can see this has been a very valuable study. And there's some observations that were done. So one is the gender and age. They measured blood pressure. They measured smoking, diabetes, and measured the cholesterol levels. And see which of these participants had a heart attack and which didn't have a heart attack, was able to identify critical risk factors for the development of atherosclerosis and therefore for the development of heart attacks and strokes. And this is a list of the most important classical risk factors of atherosclerosis. So on the one hand, high cholesterol levels, we talked about this. And we can differentiate between the cholesterol levels because there's the so-called bad cholesterol, that is the LDL cholesterol that we talked about it, so the major transport of cholesterol in the bloodstream. But another risk factor is also to have low HDL cholesterol, which is the so-called good cholesterol. And often when you go to the doctor and they measure cholesterol, you get a ratio HDL to total cholesterol or HDL to LDL, which gives you a ratio. But in the end, it's very much driven by the amount of LDL cholesterol, which is really the primary driver of the disease. Another very important risk factor is high blood pressure or hypertension. Smoking is an important risk factor that one can obviously control. Diabetes, age obviously. Men are more prone to develop heart attacks at an earlier age. Later on, in older women, it's actually the risk is the same actually. And obviously there's a lot of genetics involved. Not necessarily only in familial hypercholesterolemia, where you have one gene that is affected in the lipoprotein metabolism, but there's many different genes that may be important in modulating these levels of cholesterol and the lipoprotein metabolism, but also modulating other factors that have a positive or negative influence on the development and the progression of atherosclerotic lesions. So how do we study atherosclerosis? We can do epidemiological studies, we can do observational studies with humans, but what has been very helpful is to study animal models of atherosclerosis. And so this is an interesting slide because it comes actually from Brown and Goldstein, and they just put together all the different animal models that have been published to develop atherosclerosis, or where people have studied atherosclerosis. And in fact, what the major message of this is that every animal model where you somehow achieve to raise the cholesterol levels will develop atherosclerotic lesions, and that can be parrots or pigeons or geese, you name it, they develop atherosclerotic lesions. And I've spent many years in San Diego, and this is a very atypical model, but one day in SeaWorld in San Diego, this harbor seal was found dead. And they didn't know what it had, actually. And so when they examined it, you could look here at the nose. What does this remind you of? Xanthomas, exactly. So they didn't know that, of course, but I mean, these are obviously cholesterol deposits. And when they opened it up, and then they looked at the aorta, you cannot see it here, but it was calcified and full of atherosclerotic lesions. That specific seal seemed to have some genetic mutation that caused some defects in the lipoprotein metabolism, but you can see most likely that died of a heart attack. But obviously these are too difficult to keep and probably not very feasible, so what we are usually doing is we are examining animal models such as mice. And mice are very useful because, as you know, they can be genetically modified. There's many different knockout strains available that allow us to test the contribution of one or the other gene to the development of atherosclerotic lesions. And the way how we do that is in two ways. So there's two typical models. One is the apolipoprotein E deficient mouse, a knockout mouse for ApoE. So ApoE is a protein that is in the that is important for VLDL cholesterol. And that protein is responsible for binding to the LDL receptor, similar to ApoB in the LDL. So if you knock it out, obviously the VLDL, LDL particles cannot be cleared from the blood and they start to accumulate. Similar to the disease of familial hypercholesterolemia, there's also mice available that are deficient in the low-density lipoprotein receptor. And we prefer that model because these mice develop atherosclerotic lesions that are very similar to human atherosclerotic lesions. And they have a lipoprotein profile, so these lipids, the cholesterol, the carriers, very similar to the humans, where we have an enrichment in the low-density or LDL lipoproteins, then VLDL lipoproteins, and very little HDL lipoproteins. Now, when we then feed these animals a diet that is rich in cholesterol, typically for 8 to 12 weeks, we then can actually quantify the development of atherosclerotic lesions in by two means. One thing is that we take the entire aorta after we sacrifice the mouse, and we cut it open, as you can see here. I don't have something to draw here, but so what you can see here, so this is where basically the aorta splits into the femoral arteries to supply the hind legs, and then we basically cut it open on one side and make a flat bed of the entire aorta. And this is the arch, so this is where it comes out of the heart. And then we stain it, similar to what Anichkov already has done, with a specific stain, a Sudan 4 stain that specifically stains neutral lipids. And then what you can see here is wherever you have red, you have actually lipid deposits, you have atherosclerosis. And then we take a computer program, we quantify the entire aorta, the area of the entire aorta, and then we quantify how much of the entire aorta is red, and then we see so and so many percent atherosclerosis per aorta, so 25% is covered by atherosclerotic lesions. Obviously, that specific measurement only gives you a two-dimensional measurement. Right, so the advantage of these histological cross-sections that we can get a three-dimensional picture. So what you see here is actually the so-called valve area of the aorta. There used to be, I don't know, unfortunately I cannot draw, but we used to have something to draw. But when you have the heart, the aorta comes out here, and where the left ventricle pumps the blood into the aorta, and it's separated from the heart chamber or the left ventricle by valves, and these are three valves that make sure that when the heart stops pumping, that the blood doesn't flow back into the heart. And so interestingly, in mice, lesions first develop underneath these valves. And you can see here that there is, so you can see here these crystal deposits, as well as the, you can see here these crystal deposits here, as well as some lesion area. And we do this in sequential sections over 400 micrometer and then measure every seventh or every ninth section so we can then take a three-dimensional picture of the atherosclerotic lesions. So you see this mouse has very little lesions and this has a lot of lesions. And therefore we can then get a true measurement and quantify the extent of atherosclerosis either as an average lesion size or a three-dimensional all right. So how do these atherosclerotic lesions develop? I mentioned to you that one of the major risk factors for atherosclerosis are low-density lipoproteins, or high levels of low-density lipoproteins, because they are the major transporter of cholesterol in the circulation. And at specific sites in the artery wall, large and medium-sized arteries, LDL enters the artery wall and gets trapped in there. And then once it gets trapped in there, due to the fact that there's a lot of glycosaminoglycans in the subendothelial space, and some of these, such as proteoglycans, do bind LDL because there's some charge. There's some positively charged area in the LDL particles that can bind to the negatively charged area of these glucosaminoglycans. It becomes trapped there, so it's retained. It cannot easily get out of it, back into the bloodstream. And so while it is trapped there, these LDL particles are chemically altered or biochemically altered. And one of the major alterations is that they become oxidized. And so first, these particles form so-called minimally modified or minimally oxidized LDL particles. And they now gain new functions, new biological activities. And one of the major new biological activities that these early forms of oxidized LDL gain is that they actually are pro-inflammatory. And as such, they can activate endothelial cells. And these endothelial cells, again, here's the bloodstream, here's the intima, here's the smooth muscle cell layer, they express chemokine receptors on their surface, leading to the recruitment of monocytes into the artery wall. And these monocytes then differentiate into macrophages. And these macrophages, again, have a number of enzymes that can further propagate the oxidation of oxidized LDL. And what is interesting now is that, and we will come back to it, that now the oxidized LDL gains another new biological function that is very important and becomes a hallmark of the inflammation of the endothelium is, which leads to the recruitment of inflammatory cells into the cells, is a study where Myra Jabalski actually examined the effect of deficiency of one of these adhesion molecules on vascular cells, like endothelial cells, for the development of atherosclerosis. So he took one group of mice, in this case these were APOE mice, I believe, that had a completely functional vascular cell adhesion molecule on endothelial cells, and another group that had a mutation, so they had a dysfunctional vascular cell adhesion molecule. And he fed these mice a diet and then compared this, and you can see that both in the entire aorta or in the aortic arch, you can see that those mice that had a dysfunctional vascular cell adhesion molecule, which is a typical sign of a vascular inflammation and responsible for the recruitment of leukocytes, that those mice had significantly less atherosclerosis, demonstrating that VCAM and adhesion and recruitment of cells into the vascular wall is a limiting step for the development of atherosclerotic lesions. Now, once that happens, I mentioned to you typically monocytes that enter the artery wall that differentiate into macrophages, LDL can become further oxidized. And so there's many different ways how oxidized LDL can be pro-inflammatory. We mentioned a few things, such as pro-inflammatory gene expression, so inducing inflammation in cells, or monocyte adhesion. But one of the probably most important steps for the development of atherosclerotic lesions is that oxidized LDL, different from native, non-oxidized LDL, can actually be taken up by macrophages. So when you would take, for example, macrophages and incubate them with normal native LDL, isolated from normal humans, nothing would happen. They would downregulate the LDL receptor, they would not take up the cholesterol. And so it was quite puzzling because already Anishkov has shown that there's these cells full with cholesterol inside, and it was not clear how does cholesterol get into these macrophages inside the cells. And we now know that actually this is due to specific scavenger receptors such as CD36 or SRA that are taking up oxidized LDL. And this is how in a cell culture, for example, macrophages look. When you then treat them with oxidized LDL, suddenly you see that they start to accumulate lipids in an uncontrolled manner inside the cell, and you can again stain them with that red dye for these lipids. Now the story behind this discovery was actually quite interesting, because there was in the late 80s and in the 90s, everybody after the discovery of Brown and Goldstein wanted to know how do these foam cells develop. Nobody would understand this. And so Brown and Goldstein actually did an experiment where they simply acetylated, so chemically modified LDL, and then added this chemically modified acetylated LDL to the macrophages, and suddenly this showed that this could lead to foam cell formation because they take up the oxidized LDL. Now that's not very physiological. Even then, nobody even thought that there would be any acetylation physiologically at all. Now we know that it's important for histone acetylation, but LDL does not get acetylated. So many labs were interested in understanding why, what is the mechanism that makes LDL being taken up by macrophages via scavenger receptors. So several labs were working on that. One of them was Dan Steinberg's lab, the other one was Joe Wittstam's lab. And they actually were in the same building at the University of California in San Diego, separated by two floors, and they basically did the same experiment. They thought maybe if we take the LDL and culture them with endothelial cells, which is sort of the inner layer of the blood vessels, maybe this does something to the LDL particles, changes them somehow, and then they become ligands for the scavenger receptors and being taken up by macrophages. And so one day, one of the postdocs in Dan Steinberg's lab actually cultured LDL that he isolated from some donors with endothelial cells, isolated it from the media of the endothelial cells out, put them to the macrophages, and suddenly he found that it was taken up by these macrophages, generated more foam cells. But what was interesting is when they then shared this data with Joe Wittstam's lab, they did exactly the same experiment, but didn't see that actually. And so they went back and really in very much detail compared the notes and found that actually they had one thing that was different. In Dan Steinberg's lab, they used a media, culture media, that did not have any antioxidants, and the other one had antioxidants in it. And this is how actually the oxidation hypothesis of atherosclerosis was born, which is now probably still the most viable hypothesis of why oxidized LDL, or why LDL is taken up by macrophages. So in contrast to native LDL, which is taken up by an LDL receptor that usually is not expressed in these circumstances on the surface, oxidized LDL is taken up by different scavenger receptors, of which CD36 and SRA are the most important. Now, once these lesions develop later on, other inflammatory cells are recruited, including T cells. And we know now that prominently Th1 cells can interact and have a crosstalk with other lesional cells are typically found in atherosclerotic lesions, particularly at the shoulder areas of the atherosclerotic lesions. Why do we call them shoulder areas? Because this is the cellular rich area where next to it you have a very lipid rich part that is full of foam cells, but also full of dying apoptotic foam cells that release all the lipid, which you can find inside here. And these smooth muscle cells become also activated. The internal elastic lamina is disrupted. The smooth muscle cells migrate into the intima of the lesions and start to form probably a protective shield to protect these macrophages from getting into contact with the bloodstream, by also secreting a number of fibrous collagens and proteoglycan, causing this fibrous cap. However, if the disease further progresses, you eventually have only very few cells left, and you have a lot of extracellular lipid, or this lipid gruel, what is it called here. And the smooth muscle cell fibrous cap becomes very thin, and by the activity of macrophages that secrete proteases, such as matrix metalloproteases, these fibrous caps become more and more degraded, which is dangerous because eventually it can rupture. And once it ruptures, all the material that is released here, particularly material that carries a protein called tissue factor that initiates blood clotting and thrombosis, is released, gets into contact with the bloodstream, platelets start to aggregate, and you can form a blood clot. And if that blood clot is not quickly resolved, it starts to occlude the blood vessel, and then you have a heart attack if your coronary artery is affected. All right? So when we talk about a vulnerable plaque. And so vulnerable plaques are characterized by the fact that they usually have a very thin cap. This is an autopsy specimen from a person that died of a heart attack. It's a coronary artery, and you can see actually that the blood flow is not very much occluded when you just had the lesion that was sort of growing outside. But obviously, here you had the thrombus that also forms then inside where the material is released, and this one on this side completely occluded the artery, causing the fatal heart attack. This, when somebody comes to the hospital with a heart attack, you can see when you look by coronary angiograms, which is where you put the dye into the bloodstream, right? And then on an X-ray, you can look, you can basically look and present the coronary arteries, and you can see here, at this site here and this site here, obviously there is the blood flow disrupted because you have some occlusion. But this is typically where you can put it in stand and you hold it up, and if it's done quickly enough, so if you're in a good area where you can get to an emergency room where they can do this angioplasty, put your stand in there, then usually the heart, the myocardium does not get necrotic. However, if you're too late, if it gets necrotic, and you will eventually have a malfunctional heart that causes heart failure later on. So what is important to understand here is that atherosclerosis per se is not dangerous because the lesion grows inside and starts to occlude the bloodstream, because typically what it does, it grows more to the outside. And even if you have it like this, it is not very dangerous because you see you have a very thick fibrous cap. However, what is really dangerous is if you have something that is a big lesion with a lot of lipid deposits and only a very thin fibrous cap here. And that is dangerous because, as I mentioned to you before, under the activity of inflammatory cells, typically also during flu season, you have more heart attacks because you have a hyperactivation of the immune system causing a lot of chemokines, cytokines, and matrix metalloproteases being expressed here. They can degrade this cap here, and that causes then the heart attack that causes the thrombus that can either cause a heart attack, and if it heals, you maybe have a little bit of an obstructed blood flow, but it's not dangerous as such. So the goal for us is now to really identify these dangerous lesions and ideally by biomarkers or by some imaging strategies, because then we can treat these patients and hope that by treating these patients we can reduce or stabilize the plaque by reducing the lipids that are accumulating. So again, this here is something you see only when you have typically an occlusion due to a thrombotic event, but not because the lesion simply grows in there. So it grows in there. So it's not what people would say that it's like a tubing of a plumber and there's some calcification that obstructs the blood flow. The really dangerous things are these lesions that would look normal in an angiogram, and only when they rupture give you the problem. So we have now talked a lot about the role of cholesterol. Obviously, it's very important because the disease is characterized by deposits of cholesterol in the vessel wall. But there's a number of other modulators that can affect and modulate the course of disease. And one of them is inflammation. And it was in the last maybe 15, 20 years that became more and more apparent that inflammation also plays a role. But similar to what I said about cholesterol and Anishinaabe, this also goes back several hundred years. And what you can see here is that these were these two big pathologies in the 19th century. One of them here in Vienna, the chairman of pathology, Karl von Hopitansky, and in Germany, Rudolf Virchow, that actually had very opposing views on how atherosclerosis developed. For example, Virchow, he was more the microscopy pathologist, wanted to see things, and he talked about a chronic end arteritis deformans, so a deforming inflammation of the blood vessel, and says, here you have a primary inflammatory driven disease, because he didn't have immunohistochemistry then, but he saw inflammatory cells under the microscope. And then there was the more morphological pathologist here in Vienna, who always was more interested in understanding the morphology when he opened up in autopsies and saw this. And he had the thought that one of the major drivers is not a local reaction, but it's something in the blood. And probably in the end, both are right. He couldn't say that it was then cholesterol that is really responsible. And he already predicted that there's an inflammatory component, but probably the causative event for the inflammation is actually the accumulation of cholesterol. And so it was not only under the turn of this century that Russell Ross, a famous pathologist from Seattle, defined the so-called response to injury hypothesis. And he had his landmark review where he, for the first time, suggested atherosclerosis is an inflammatory disease. And this is really what now a lot of laboratories around the world try to understand: what is causing inflammation, why is there inflammation in atherosclerotic lesions, why does the position of cholesterol lead to an inflammatory reaction, because there's obviously no bacterial or viral infection going on. And we still don't know it really today. We know certain parts of it, and in the end we don't know whether targeting inflammation could be a way to treat atherosclerosis. And we'll talk about this later on. But there is, again, a number similar to the LDL cholesterol epidemiological studies that have taught us a lot about the role of inflammation. And so there is a marker, it's an acute phase protein that you can measure in the blood, that typically you measure when you suspect someone has a bacterial infection. It's called C-reactive protein. It goes up dramatically in the blood. It's produced by the liver when you have a bacterial infection. But it was found that when you measure at the low range of this, at high sensitive range, the C-reactive protein levels, they can be also a biomarker for chronic inflammation. And so by measuring these sensitive CRP measurements across a population with cardiovascular disease, all these studies have actually showed that individuals that had elevated levels of CRP, so signs of chronic inflammation, were at higher risk to develop a heart attack or a stroke or peripheral artery disease. And it seems that they go hand in hand with cholesterol, because this is very nice from Peter Libby, put together from many studies a graph where he actually on the one hand plotted the association of the risk of cholesterol, in this case he took the ratio of total cholesterol to HDL cholesterol, and on the other hand he plotted five different groups, so 20% separated these populations according to the levels of this high sensitive inflammation marker CRP. And what you can find here is that those individuals that had very low cholesterol levels and no inflammation were put at 1. And those individuals that had no inflammation but had elevated cholesterol had a fourfold higher risk to develop atherosclerosis. Now, even if you had normal cholesterol, good or low cholesterol levels, but high levels of CRP, suggesting that you had more inflammation, you had a twofold higher risk to develop a heart attack or a stroke. But what you can see here is that when you were in the unlucky position to have both very high cholesterol levels and high markers of inflammation, you had a near ninefold elevated risk compared to those individuals that had low cholesterol and low inflammation, suggesting that inflammation and cholesterol goes hand in hand. And this is how we also see this disease. We think that actually cholesterol accumulation causes inflammation, and inflammation again then drives further the disease process. What is interesting, we know that CRP per se is only a marker, because there's Mendelian randomization studies of individuals that have genetically determined different levels of CRP, and there was no association with cardiovascular disease. So having elevated CRP just like that does not do any harm. It's because CRP is a marker of inflammation. It's the inflammation that is driving the disease. Now, beyond the inflammatory component, we also know that in the broadest sense, the immune system does. So, what is now the evidence that the immune system could be involved in the development of atherosclerotic lesions? There's, on the one hand, obviously histological evidence. So when you take atherosclerotic lesions, you see typically foam cells, but you also see a number of other immune cells, such as CD4 cells and cytotoxic T cells, all of them expressing signs of activation. They secrete cytokines that you find expressed in atherosclerotic lesions. You have MHC class II expression, the antigen-presenting molecule, macrophages and other non-classical antigen-presenting cells, but you have also immunoglobulins and complement as humoral components of the immune system. So this tells us there must be an immune reaction occurring in the atherosclerotic lesions. There's also some epidemiological evidence. For example, we know that individuals who suffer from an autoimmune disease, such as systemic lupus erythematosus, or from rheumatoid arthritis, that per se does not have anything to do with atherosclerosis, they basically all have a significantly elevated risk of heart attacks and strokes. In fact, most of them die of a heart attack and stroke. Even individuals who have gingivitis, so inflammatory gingival disease, this is also a risk factor for developing atherosclerosis. So it tells you that if you have inflammation and if you have immune disease, this puts you at a higher risk of developing atherosclerosis. And there's even some single nucleotide polymorphisms that have been found within toll-like receptors or co-stimulatory molecules such as OX40 that were found to be associated with cardiovascular disease and atherosclerosis. And in the end, of course, studies of animal models have taught us a lot about individual components, whether they are promoting or protecting atherosclerosis. Now, as you know, you can separate the immune system in the innate immune system, the natural immune system, and the adaptive immune system. And on the innate side, obviously, one of the prominent cells that is involved also in atherosclerosis are macrophages. So the recruitment of monocyte macrophages to the atheroid wall and to the atherosclerotic lesions is a rate-limiting step in atherosclerosis. We know this from several studies that have looked at the contribution of different chemokine receptors within, where they found that actually chemokine receptors, knockout mice for chemokine receptors or their ligands, have all developed less atherosclerosis, atherosclerotic lesions, and we now know that actually inflammatory monocytes seem to be more relevant as the ones that are recruited in the atherosclerotic lesions and then differentiate into macrophages compared to these resident and patrolling monocytes. And a lot of work you can find in this review. It's just I want to give you an understanding that really the monocyte recruitment is an important major driver in atherosclerotic lesions. development. Interestingly, there's some data that also show that at later stages, there's another contribution that macrophages can actually proliferate in atherosclerotic lesions and further propagate to the numbers of foam cells inside atherosclerotic lesions. But in early phases of the disease, the recruitment of monocytes is really a rate-limiting step. And these are just two examples, mice lacking the receptor for monocyte chemotactic protein 1, or CCL2, the receptor is called CCL2, have less atherosclerotic lesions. Throughout the study, and mice that lack the ligand for it also have less atherosclerotic lesions. Interestingly, however, in all cases, mice still develop atherosclerotic lesions. So it's not that one or the other component is singularly responsible for the disease, but they contribute to it. Now we know, and this is very complex and unique, you don't need to go into detail here. We know that chemokines, we know now that several chemokines play different roles at different stages of diseases. So whereas CCL5 and CCL2 are very important at the initial phases, CXCR3CL1, CX3CR1 are important in advanced stages of diseases. But in the end, what you need to understand is here that this is a network of chemokine receptors that interact with monocytes, but also other inflammatory cells that control and regulate the development of atherosclerotic lesions. All right. So what are these?
Is CCL2 not binding to CCR2?
It is binding to CCL2, yeah. It's MCP1, yeah.
Yeah, but why is CCL2 important in the early phase and CCR2 important in the late phase?
Yeah, so this is because CCL2 is obviously promiscuous and binds also other ligands. It does not exclusively bind CCL2. Okay. And in this sense, we know that other ligands, such as CX3CL1, can also bind to CCL2. And therefore, it's Christian Weber's lab in Munich, they have worked out all these combinations of chemokines that bind to different pairs of chemokine receptors and the importance at different stages. That's a good point, yeah. All right, then we have the innate immune response is characterized by the recruitment of monocytes and macrophages. And I've mentioned to you before that obviously one of the hallmark features is that they take up oxidized LDL. And probably they do that because, similar to bacteria, oxidized LDL are recognized by patterns that are recognized by pattern recognition receptors. And we believe that CD36 and SRA are such pattern recognition receptors that recognize danger-associated molecular patterns on oxidized LDL. And they recognize oxidized LDL as something dangerous, and therefore the host mounts an immune response, an inflammatory response, with the goal to eventually induce resolution and get rid of what causes this inflammatory response. The problem with this disease is that you generate more and more cholesterol, oxidized LDL, and you never stop. The host is not able to eventually clean and get rid of what causes the inflammatory reaction. And therefore, it's a physiological response, because what the immune system does, it responds to where there is some danger, but it never can resolve this. And there's several aspects that can play into this. On the one hand is this constant supply of cholesterol deposits or LDL cholesterol deposits causing the inflammatory reactions. But a unique feature of these foam cells, that they are less capable of resolving as would be other macrophages in a bacterial infection, for example. So we know that this is important, because mice that are either deficient in the scavenger receptors or in the toll-like receptors that have been shown to be involved in recognizing the inflammatory component of oxidized LDL have less atherosclerosis. Now, putting this together, we know that work from Catherine Moore has shown that it's a heterotrimer between the scavenger receptor CD36 and toll-like receptor 4 pairing unusually with toll-like receptor 6, and that these can actually trigger MyD88 TRIF-dependent activation of NF-kappa-B, causing the expression of a number of chemokines that are responsible for recruiting more monocytes. Interestingly, and this an NF-kappa-B target gene is also pro-IL-1 beta and the NLRP3 inflammasome, which is an intracellular pattern recognition receptor. And recent work has actually shown that once the oxidized LDL and cholesterol is taken up, at some point the lysosomes get damaged and free cholesterol can accumulate, can form crystals, and similar to these uric acid crystals for gout, cholesterol can actually activate the NLRP3 inflammasome, leads to caspase-dependent cleavage of IL-1-beta, and the secretion of IL-1-beta and IL-18. And we know that IL-1-beta is an important inflammatory cytokine that further propagates and drives the disease. And this is important, we'll come back to that later on. So you have oxidized LDL that on the one hand triggers NF-kappa-B dependent genes such as chemokines and the activation of the NLRP3 inflammasome. But on the other hand, uptake of oxidized LDL leads to the accumulation of cholesterol crystals that directly activate the inflammasome, leading to IL-1-beta production. So that is most likely the most important innate recognition inside atherosclerotic lesions, but we're far from understanding all these processes that have to do with the recognition of different species of oxidized LDL. Now, importantly, excess cholesterol, as I mentioned to you, is taken up by HDL. And there's two receptors that are important, that's involved in that, ABCG1 and ABCA1, that efflux out, that help HDL take out the cholesterol and bring it back to the liver. And so you have defects here. This obviously causes an accumulation of cholesterol. So what about the adaptive immunity? There's two very interesting studies that have told us a lot about adaptive immunity. Mice that are deficient in the gene called recombinase activating gene, one or two, or that are these severe combined immune deficient mice, they cannot have any functional B or T cells. And so what was found when these mice were crossed on an LDL receptor or an APOE deficient background, what do you expect these mice to have? Less lesions. And so if indeed they had 40 to 70% less atherosclerosis, suggesting that the immune system, the adaptive immune system, does play a role in the development, or at least in the progression of atherosclerosis. However, what was interesting in these studies is that when these mice were fed an excessively high and rich cholesterol diet, so had very high cholesterol levels, there was no difference between RAD deficient and normal LDL receptors, APOE deficient mice, suggesting that when the levels of cholesterol are excessively high, they can overcome any modulatory function of adaptive immunity. So adaptive immune mechanisms are clearly not obligatory, so it's not an autoimmune disease, but they can modulate the disease process, and obviously they modulate under situations that are realistic for us humans because we have elevated levels that are moderately elevated and not excessively high. So within this adaptive immune system, we have T and B cells, and on the part of the T cells, we know the T cells are present inside atherosclerotic lesions. And it could also be shown by Jan Stemme of the Karolinska Institute a number of years ago when he isolated T cells from lesions of human atherosclerotic lesions, and then he actually examined the repertoire or the sequence of the T cell receptor, which tells you something about the identity of these T cells, that these were not simply T cells like you have it in the peripheral blood, but there was a restricted set of T cell receptors suggesting that there is an oligoclonal expansion of T cells. So only a restricted set of T cells were present, and this again suggests that they must recognize a specific antigen. Directly, experimentally proven, it could be shown that when you transfer CD4 T cells from mice that have atherosclerosis into SCID mice, that you can transfer disease into these mice, saying that really the CD4 cells seem to be promoting the disease. And now we know that actually, after a lot of studies looking at different subset of T cells that for primarily Th1 cells, by means of secreting interferon gamma, are major drivers of the inflammatory process of atherosclerosis. This seems to be regulated by regulatory T cells that dampen the influence. And therefore, there are a lot of studies trying to understand what the role of these individual T cells is. Recently, also CD8 cells were implicated in this response. And a lot of labs try to find ways how they can stimulate regulatory T cells that could dampen the inflammation. But since we do not know what the exact antigen is that these T cells recognize, it's still very hard to understand how we can, in an antigen-specific manner, modulate these immune responses. So Th1 cells secreting interferon gamma are major drivers of atherosclerosis, and they are particularly regulated by the regulatory cells that dampen these responses. All right. And this again shows you mice that lack the interferon gamma receptor cannot signal to me via that have half as many atherosclerotic lesions. All right. Now, on the other hand, we have B cells. And while we know a lot about the T cell population in atherosclerotic lesions driving atherosclerosis, for a long time, very little was known about the role of B cells. Particularly, B cells were not investigated much because they were not seen. When you look, examine histologically in atherosclerotic lesions, you don't find many B cells. If you find them surrounding in the adventitia, this fibrous tissue around these lesions, where you have B and T cell clusters, but you don't find them in the intima. But obviously, as I mentioned to you before, we see a lot of immunoglobulins and complement there. But it was about 15 years ago where two major studies have put them on the map. And these studies have actually suggested that B cells seem to be protective, because when pinacalli juris took out the spleen from mice, which accelerates atherosclerosis, and then put back B cells into the mice, she could protect these mice by simply transferring B cells. So in contrast to transferring T cells that promotes the disease. And also Amy Major has published it when she transplanted bone marrow from mice that cannot make functional B cells, so-called mu and T mice, that these mice have much more atherosclerosis, suggesting that if you lack B cells, you lack the protective capacity of these, and they are protective. Now, this was not the whole story, because later on, as you will see, it was found that actually there's many different flavors to B cells. And in the broad sense, we have two populations of B cells. We have B1 cells that are much smaller population, and they're responsible for secreting natural IgM antibodies, and they are part of natural immunity. So they are different from the conventional B cells in the spleen, and these are the so-called B2 cells that include marginal zone B cells and follicular B cells. And these cells are more in the adaptive immune system, secreting primarily, are responsible, giving rise to plasma cells that secrete IgG antibodies that are part of the adaptive response. Now, when you summarize all the data that have that are out there, experimental data, you can see actually that B1 cells seem to be protective, whereas other cells, the B2 cells, seem to have pro-atherogenic effects, although we don't exactly know whether follicular or marginal zone B cells are responsible for that, but we know that these B2 cells. And they seem to do it, although we really don't know it at this point, via the secretion of potentially pro-atherogenic IgG antibodies. Now, in contrast, B1 cells give rise to IgM antibodies, which could bind oxidized LDL. We know that a large part of these bind oxidized LDL, and therefore can block the inflammatory signaling via TLR4 and scavenger by simply scavenging the oxidized LDL away. But it could also promote resolution by helping the clearance of apoptotic cells. So there's two different flavors to B1 cells and B2 cells, or to B cells in atherosclerosis. And for now, we know quite substantially about B1 cells, but although we know that these seem to be promoting disease, we know very little about the mechanisms, how these could mediate atherosclerosis. So why are these interesting? These are interesting because in immune diseases, B cells present very good pharmaceutical targets. There's a lot of antibodies how you can specifically deplete certain population of B cells without doing much harm, and therefore you can easily get rid of these, obviously at expense sometimes that you're at higher risk for an infection, but if you do it the right way, you can take out maybe that population of B cells that is responsible to drive this disease, and that's why there's a lot of interest in finding ways to modulate these B cell responses. So how would these immunoglobulins that come from B cells have a role? On the one hand, you have IgM antibodies I mentioned to you, which are mostly natural antibodies, and many of them bind oxidized LDL, and you can see that they can simply neutralize the pro-inflammatory properties of oxidized LDL, so it cannot activate endothelial cells, or they can block the uptake by scavenger receptors, preventing foam cell formation, as you can see here. But at the same time, by recognizing the same structures, they can promote the clearance of apoptotic cells by macrophages, who could have protective mechanisms in many different ways. Whereas IgG antibodies could be pro-atherogenic by ligating the Fc gamma receptor on macrophages, and that could result in an inflammatory signaling or even mediate uptake of oxidized LDL and generating foam cell formation. And IgE, for example, has also been recently identified as a potentially pro-atherogenic immunoglobulin, which then can lead to degranulation of mast cells that are found in the adventitia, and they can also further promote the degradation of this fibrous cap because they secrete a lot of proteases that could mediate this blood rupture eventually. So there's a number of antigens that have been discussed. What is clear now, while viral and bacterial infections can somehow modulate the disease, they're certainly not causatively involved. And probably the most important antigen seems to be still antigens that are found when LDL becomes oxidized. While LDL itself is not immunogenic, oxidation of it generates a number of different structures on these particles that make it now visible to the immune system, and they can trigger immune responses that could potentially influence and modulate the inflammatory process during atherosclerotic lesion formation. I have mentioned this to you before, that oxidized LDL is present in vivo. It is found in atherosclerotic lesions of all studies and all animal models that have been so far investigated. And I mentioned to you it can act many ways. It can be pro-inflammatory, start inflammatory process. It can be a ligand for foam cell formation, which leads to the uptake of oxidized LDL, and crystal formation that trigger inflammasome activation. But it can be an antigen that is seen by both IgG antibody, IgM antibodies, as well as by a number of T cells that can be part of this inflammatory process. Now, these antibodies in particular may be interesting biomarkers, and it has been shown that actually antibodies to oxidized LDL correlate with atherosclerotic lesion formation, but this has not been very solid in many studies. So people investigated if individuals with high antibody titers would have more atherosclerosis, and some studies showed this relationship, others didn't. And only recently it became clear that there is a big difference between IgM and IgG antibodies, which is consistent with what I've shown you about B1 cells and B2 cells, that IgM antibodies, if you have high levels, you seem to have less disease, but this is not the case with IgG antibodies. But still, we know too little at this point, and we try to understand more about this. Now, we'll not go into this. I would like to quickly discuss for the last 5 minutes with you what would be the therapeutic approaches to treat atherosclerosis. So what would be a therapeutic approach to treat atherosclerosis? Cholesterol-lowering drugs would be a very good one, exactly. Sometimes it's too late for that, and then you have to do this. Even before you have a heart attack, so he was diagnosed with a multivessel atherosclerotic disease at the end of his presidency, and what he got is a quadruple bypass. So he had four bypass. What you do with a bypass, you take usually an artery from the mama from here that supplies your chest, and then you transplant it to bridge the blood flow from the aorta to the functional part of the coronary artery, because this is in such bad shape, the coronary artery is up there, that you cannot have any blood flow. But obviously we want to avoid that. And so how can you lower cholesterol? As you mentioned, this is one of the ways, because it's one of the major risk factors. One of them would be diet. Individually, it can be very difficult. So if you have a patient that comes in and you want to try diet, mostly you can manage to lower cholesterol with diet by 10%. For some it works better, for others not. But typically they come to you at a stage where they have had elevated cholesterol levels for a long time, and then the LDL receptors seem to be downregulated, and you cannot upregulate them that easily by diet. But on a population level, this is a very nice study in which in Lyon, two groups of individuals were either remained on their normal diet, or they were put on a low cholesterol diet, on a healthy diet. And then they were followed up prospectively for 5 years, and what you can see here is that already after a few years, they separated. And those individuals that remained on the normal diet, you had actually only 80% of these individuals that did not have a heart attack. Whereas in the experimental group, it was more than 90%, suggesting that diet can make a difference. But as I mentioned to you before, on an individual level, often this is not good enough. And so how could you influence the levels of cholesterol? There's many different possibilities. The simplest one, it's actually also the totally safest one, is a bile acid resin, because it binds bile acids, prevents the cholesterol to be taken up here And then you secrete it in your stool, you have fatty stools there, and you get very much discomfort. But this is a drug that actually works. It does not lower cholesterol dramatically, but if you cannot tolerate any other drugs, this is typically what you can give. The other thing is niacin, which has to do with the assembly of VLDL cholesterol. The exact mechanism of action is still not known. But the most important ones are so-called statins. And we will talk about that later. And in context with that, we know that there's these anti-PCSK9 inhibitors, that very new drugs that have been approved only last year, and where the outcome trials are still not out, but are phenomenal in lowering cholesterol. Important for some individuals that do not tolerate statins or that have excessively high cholesterol. So what is the therapeutic goal? The therapeutic goal is to get cholesterol levels below 130 milligrams if you are at moderate risk. So no family history or young adults with familial hypercholesterolemia. But if you had already a family history, or if you're an individual with disease, then you should get it below 100 milligrams, sometimes even below 70 milligrams per deciliter LDL cholesterol. And one of the ways to achieve this are the so-called statins, or the HMG-CoA reductase inhibitors. So what they do is, they inhibit one enzyme that is important in the synthesis of cholesterol. But this is not the mechanism how they work. What they do is by inhibiting the cholesterol levels inside cells, to use that mechanism that I described to you before, this SREBP-dependent mechanism. And you basically increase the expression of the LDL receptor, which is now on the surface, and now the LDL receptor can take up the cholesterol from the circulation. And that lowers cholesterol very efficiently, even to some degree the triglycerides, and to the same degree also results in a dramatic reduction of coronary events. And there's some side effects, but they're not very dramatic, which is myopathy. And this is just summarizing a number of studies where you can see that, that in these three different studies, you have a parallel lowering of cholesterol and LDL cholesterol resulting in a decreased extent of atherosclerosis. And interestingly also, all-cause mortality being decreased. Because there's always these rumors that it's dangerous and people would die of cancer, but this is simply not true. All right. When you look at this secondary and the primary prevention trial, you can see that to the same extent that you lower cholesterol with these drugs, you can lower the risk of coronary artery disease. And so this would give you, in primary prevention trial, an ideal goal of LDL cholesterol below 70, and for secondary cholesterol, even much lower. But the evidence is there. Lowering cholesterol lowers the development of atherosclerosis. Now, quickly, this new drug, PCSK9 inhibitors, were actually discovered by a genetic mutation in a gene called PCSK9. And these individuals were found in a Dallas Heart Study where they had a SNP in the PCSK9 gene that was not functional. There was actually a hyperactive mutant. And so that gene it was not functional, and they had actually less atherosclerosis. And then later on, a hyperactive mutant was found that was associated with increased atherosclerosis. And then the exact mechanism was identified as being an important protein that is promoting the degradation of the LDL receptor. So if you target this and get rid of the PCSK9, you prevent degradation of the LDL receptor, and you keep more LDL receptors on the liver surface, and therefore you can deplete the cholesterol. And that works really dramatically well, lowers the cholesterol to levels that we've never seen before, down to 30 milligrams per deciliter of LDL cholesterol, and we're now awaiting the outcome trials if it also leads to decreased cardiovascular events. So what would be the other goal? According to my lecture, what would be the other way to treat atherosclerosis, if not lowering cholesterol?
about the plaques and for
lowering inflammation.
Exactly, lowering inflammation. So for up to now, we do not know whether lowering inflammation has any effect on atherosclerosis. But there's two studies out there that test this hypothesis. One is the so-called CANTOS trial, which is providing a drug called canakinumab, an anti-inflammatory thrombosis outcome study. And in that trial, they received this antibody that specifically neutralizes interleukin-1 beta. I've mentioned to you before, it's an important cytokine. So interleukin-1 beta, in this preliminary data, in this 17,000 patient, has been shown to inhibit inflammation, because what you can see that while it did not lower cholesterol, in these patients, the CRP went down, so they have less inflammation. And next year, it will be out, there will be an outcome, and we will find out whether inhibiting just one cytokine, so one aspect of inflammation, without changing the LDL cholesterol levels, would also result in decreased atherosclerosis. Obviously, if that works, that will start a whole new area of cardiovascular drug research, because then we know that we can also look at targeting inflammation. Targeting and lowering cholesterol, we could reduce the event rate by 50%, but what is with the other 50%? So maybe combining lowering cholesterol together with an anti-inflammatory approach would be a modern and new way to treat both the inflammatory component as well as the metabolic component of this disease. Now, this is a second trial. It's low-dose methotrexate, which is typically given here to rheumatoid arthritis patients, all the lowering inflammation. This is also ongoing and will be a second interesting trial to look to give us an insight into the role of inflammation. Yeah. And with this, I am at the end and happy to answer any questions if you wish. But you also can always write me an email and ask me about that. Thank you.